Thanks for listening to the Lunch and Learn with Dr. Barry, here to help educate, motivate, and put you on the right path to take control of your health through weekly discussions on topics in the medical field, public health arena, and in your community. And now your host, Dr. Barry.
And again, welcome to another edition of the Lunch and Learn with Dr. Barry, bringing you episode 58 of our Lunch and Learn series. Today, we are talking about why your doctor is so frustrated, and I got lots of reasons. Again, I'm not saying I'm frustrated, but I'm talking in general why your doctor may be frustrated, and just judging off the past couple weeks, it's pretty evident that there's a lot of physicians who really aren't happy with where they're at, what they're doing from a job and career standpoint. And I want to kind of let the audience know, especially in my Lunch and Learn community, that it is something that physicians are facing on a day-to-day basis. I want to kind of give you an inside look on why. But first of all, I want to stop and say thank you to all my well-wishers who's been looking out for me in the past week or so. If you, depending on when you're listening to this, you realize that I did not do an episode last week. Why? Because my kids got me so sick. I mean sick. They got the whole house sick. It usually happens this way. One of them gets sick and then the whole house ends up getting sick. But I ended up having to, one, call off work because it was so bad. I lost my voice. Again, like, I'm just now getting it back. I didn't do any videos. I didn't do anything because I couldn't even talk on the videos because my voice was so bad. So thank you for all my well-wishers for who are looking out for their episode 58 of last week. I wish it had came out, but we're here this week. We're back in full effect, back on our regularly scheduled program. And like always, if you want today's show notes, head over to drpierresblog.com/LLP058 or lunchlearnpod.com. You'll get the show notes both ways. You'll get all of the episode clips for both ways. If you haven't had a chance, go ahead and check out episode 57 as well, where we talk about why the media seems to want to put everyone on life support whenever they get sick and end up in a hospital, right? So, like always, head over to the show notes, drpierresblog.com/LLP058 or lunchlearnpod.com, and get ready for another great episode and find out today why your doctor is so frustrated right now. Hey, so first I want to start off with the episode. I want to talk about a recent lecture I had, keynote for at my hospital, Wellington Regional. And the topic of discussion was transition of care, right? Which essentially means, how do I get the patient from the hospital bed back to the doctor's office, right? And it was pretty eye-opening for lots of different reasons. One, I did not realize that it was going to be such a hot topic, especially amongst the local primary care providers in the area, because, I mean, trust me, it got so bad, I ended up having to stay almost an hour past my speech schedule, just still fielding questions and trying to, you know, work on solutions, because it was such a hot button issue for a lot of the primary care doctors. And in that, I noticed that there was a lot of pent up frustration, not necessarily with the hospital or my lecture or the lecture topic, but just something that had been building up within the outpatient providers for a while. That here I was, I kind of served as a sounding board to kind of get it off their chest, right? And, you know, things such as, you know, not being listened to, right? That it was something that heard quite frequently, where you had your outpatient provider saying, hey, I've been telling the hospital you should do this, I've been telling the hospital you should do that, and no one's listening to me, right? And growing up, if you've ever been in a situation where you're trying to plead your case, you're trying to tell your story, but no one seems to be listening, you can see how frustrated it was, frustrating that is back then, right? So imagine, you know, being a physician out in the community trying to take care of your patient, and here this hospital, this facility, this place that's supposed to be taking care of your patient isn't doing a good job taking your patient, and they're not listening to some of the solutions you have on trying to take care of your patients, right? So that was one thing that was pretty evident right off the bat. Another thing that I've found pretty common amongst the outpatient providers, especially when talking about this discussion on how to get their patients back to their office, right, is that it didn't seem like they were being brought in the discussion of trying to find a solution, right? So, again, they were frustrated because no one was listening to them, and then they were frustrated because it felt like people who were trying to make solutions weren't even including them in the decision making, right? Which I can tell you, for a physician, is probably some of the hardest things we have to deal with. One, someone not listening to us, and two, someone not following our direction, right? We absolutely hate that. I remember being a primary care provider, and again, you know, for those who know, have been following me, you know, I actually hate the term primary care provider. I think it, you know, really belittles the amount of work that an outpatient physician does, whether you're an internist, family medicine physician, pediatrician. I think it really, you know, belittles like that term and just says, oh, you're just a primary care provider, right? Like, again, it's, I think it's BS, but again, for this topic, we'll use primary care provider or outpatient provider kind of interchangeably. So you got these physicians who've been out in the community for years, some people who have been practicing longer than I've been alive. Again, I'm 35 years old. Some people have been practicing longer than I've been alive, and here they are still not being listened to and still not being able to put any input when it comes to solutions, right? So that was one thing I noticed from my topic of discussion that was evident pretty quickly, right? Another thing that I saw, especially with the outpatient providers and within the hospital, is that they seem to be getting a lot of the blame, right? So it seemed to be that a lot of the blame was being shifted onto them. But again, when just going through my discussion, it was pretty evident that there was plenty of blame to kind of be spread around. And I had one physician, you know, who was so frustrated, he said, you know what, I'm just going to not send my patients over here, right? Like, he was that frustrated, right? And it was one of those kind of pleas for help, like saying, hey, like, what do I have to do to get some help around here, right? And he said, I'm just going to stop sending my patients right here, right? Of course, he was not going to do that. It was, again, it was a little bit more of a frustration, but I could feel his pain, especially because I'm in the driver's seat, right? But I've seen both worlds, right? And just to give you a quick bio on myself, right? When I got out of residency in 2014, I went into outpatient medicine, but I also did inpatient medicine. I also worked in the nursing homes. I also did home visits. So I've kind of done all of the different facets of medicine that you can kind of think of. So I understand the plights and the positives and negatives of each different specialty, right? So here I was as this, you know, now I'm an inpatient academic physician who is trying to plead the case of why we all, and when I say we all, I mean the outpatient physicians, the inpatient physicians, the hospitals, the nursing homes, why we all need to kind of get together, right? And you know, get our act together, right? For the greater good of the patient, right? Because at the end of the day, it's all about the patient, right? But here it was, these outpatient providers feeling like they were getting all of the blame for the problems. They were, no one was listening to them for solutions, and no one was even including them when it came to decision making, right? So that's kind of where we started off. Where I started off seeing, like, okay, well, I got a lot of upset doctors in the area, right? And as a patient, right, you may not really understand why your doctor acts a certain way. You may not understand why every time you go to your doctor's office, he's always talking about the insurance company, or he's always talking about billing, or he's always talking about how he has to see too many patients. But I want you to kind of get a mindset on this side here to kind of understand why some of the things actually happen to occur, right? Moving forward, right? Again, if this situation wasn't enough, right? Moving forward, I recently had to go to a lecture conference, right, to get some classes for my license, right? I had to renew my license, so I needed, there's some required courses, especially in the state of Florida, that you need to do just to be able to renew your license, right? So I was there, and it's in the state of Florida, but I met a lot of my old attendings, right? A lot of my old attendings were there, and a lot of older physicians were there, along with younger physicians, but a lot of older physicians were there, and I just, you know, just kind of chopping it up and wrapping with some of my old attendings and, you know, asking, you know, very pointed questions, right? A good friend of mine, Dr. Watson Ducatel, who has been on a previous episode where we talked about how everyone has high blood pressure. The thing he likes to do, right, is ask them how well are they doing right now, right? This is a question that we don't really think about. I think especially as a physician, we're so used to taking care of our patients, right? We're so used to asking about the well-being of our patients, right? That sometimes we forget to ask about the well-being of our other colleagues, right? So his thing is he likes to ask, how well are you doing now, right? And, you know, almost to the T, right, when he would ask some of our older, physicians and my older attendings, right, we would get like almost like a monologue, right? We would get this sense of frustration, right? We would get this sense of loss, I'd say, and I honestly have to say loss because, again, one of my old attendings, right, he actually kind of went through a list of regrets he had, right, and things that he wished he could have done differently if he would have started out. And one of the first things that he pointed out, right, which like kind of hit me in the chest, right, when he said, if I could go back in time, right, I would go and get some equity, right? And what, for those, you know, who may not be thinking, like, what does that mean? Like, he wanted to say, he said, instead of like renting out a room, right, he would have maybe got a building, right? He would have went to own something, right? And this is something that physicians are really being faced with, especially on the negative end, right? That a lot of times we're going into this career field and we're not really owning anything, right? Like everything is rented. The building is rented. The room is rented. The equipment is, like, everything is kind of borrowed time, but nothing really essentially belongs to us, even though, you know, it's our signature that's keeping the lights on, right? Even though it's our signature that's essentially driving industries, and I mean entire industries. And I joke to say, okay, I'm in South Florida, right? There's probably a million home health agencies in South Florida, right? Again, it's hyperbole, right? But there's a lot of them, right? But none of them would be able to prosper, right, if some physician does not sign off on anything that they're doing, right? And that's what's so crazy. There's a lot of industries based around the fact of the physician who goes to school, does their residency training, and, you know, gets licensed, right? And these industries wouldn't even make a single dime if not for that physician. But a lot of times, physician isn't getting any of that ownership back, right? So that was one of the things he really pointed out. Right off the bat, he said, if I could go back in time, I would just own something, right? Like, I would, like, have some type of control. And he felt that, again, even though he had been practicing for this long and he was so accomplished, he didn't have any control of what he was doing. And he had recently kind of switched jobs, and he recently kind of made some career changes that kind of gave him some of that control back. And he felt that he was happier now than he was years ago, even when he was training me, right? So, you know, that kind of hit me, you know, right off, you know, right at the bat, right? Because, again, I'm young, right? Like, I'm not 5 years out of residency, right? I'm not even 4 years out of residency. And these are things that I like to know, right? Because these are things, like, I don't want to make the same mistakes, right, going forward, right? I don't want to be, you know, 10 years in a game, 15 years in this game, and then be upset at the world and, you know, be upset at my patients and, you know, always seem like the meanie when I'm walking around my clinic, right? I don't want to do that. So it's kind of eye-opening to kind of see some of these burdens and these gripes that my older colleagues were having, right? Because, again, it's something that if they're having these older, if they're having these gripes, I need to do something to make sure I avoid to have them when I get their age. And just kind of, again, we talked to several physicians around there, and I think there was like a very common theme around, you know, why they were frustrated, right? Again, this is why we're listening, right? Like, what's happening right now, especially in 2018, that your doctor's upset, right? Because, again, on the outside looking in, if you're a physician, right, you're supposed to be making all of this money and you're, you know, at the top of the food chain in regards to the career. Like, what's happening? And a lot of it kind of boiled down to these, like, four things, right? And we're going to talk about these four things that I think is, you know, pretty pertinent, right? The first one, right, is money, right? Like, money is a difficult discussion to have, especially when you're talking about, you know, physician salary versus, you know, someone else's salary, someone not in like that career field. because in the career field of medicine, right, a physician who makes like $150,000 a year, right, that seems like a lot of money. But in their eyes, they're like, you know, that's not a lot of money. Again, I say jokingly, I had friends when I was in medical school who told me they would not turn their head to stop the alarm for less than $150,000 a year, right? Like, it was just something that when you're in this world, right, money has a totally different connotation to it, right? But when again, I kind of alluded to earlier, right, when you're a physician, when you were pre-med and then you were in medical school, and then you went to residency, when you realize the amount of money that gets generated because of all of that blood, sweat, and tears that you kind of went through, only to realize that in the grand scheme of things, especially, when we talk about the piece of the pie when it comes to who makes money in medicine, right? To understand that, you know, you're at like the bottom of it, right? Like, it's sad, and it's almost heartbreaking, right? Because again, a lot of my colleagues go into medicine, right? And that's all they do, right? You know, that's nothing but medicine, right? Like, the only way they generate any type of income is through medicine, right? And for those who know and those who follow me know that that's one thing that I've always been a champion of not doing, right? Like, I've always been a champion of making sure that, yes, medicine can provide a good income, but you better be doing something else, especially if you're a physician, right? You better be doing something else to generate more income. Because again, one day, again, last week I was sick, right? Again, that was a temporary thing, right? But last week I was sick and I couldn't practice any medicine. So imagine if the only way I was able to generate income was actually going to the clinic. I would have to go to the clinic sick. And again, that's kind of like the scenario I want you to kind of think about when you have these, you know, these people who really go into a profession where if they're not doing that thing, they're not making any money. In this day and age, right, we have a lot of physicians, right, who are practicing, and I hate to say it, right, maybe practicing a little bit longer than they really should have, especially when it comes to age, when it comes to medical knowledge, when it comes to trying to adapt with the newer times. But the reason why they have to do it is because financially they just can't stop and quit, right? Financially, they weren't preparing themselves, right? Financially, something happened and you know what? They had a setback and now they still got to keep working, right? And I can tell you right now, I do not expect to see myself be like this, you know, 50, 60, 70 year old physician, right, who's in the clinic still having to do that, right? Like, I'm telling you, I will be taking a step back by the time I get to that age, right? Because I just can't see myself not because I don't want to do it, right? But I feel like I'd be much better used somewhere else and letting a younger generation kind of take in and, you know, do the day-to-day work, right? So that's one thing, right? The money, right? Another reason why your doctor is frustrated is regulation, right? And unless for some reason you're just not paying attention to the news or any health-related news at all, right? Physician in their work is becoming so regulated, and a lot of the power and control is just out of their hands, right? You have these politicians who have no career in medicine, right? No background in health, right? No background in taking care of patients, right? Making decisions on your behalf, right? And unless you give them a lot of money, right? Unless you donate a lot of money to their campaigns, right? They don't want to hear what you have to say. So you have these politicians, right? Whose sole job is really to take care of the biggest lobbying firms, right, making decisions on how you should take care of someone in your office. And it's becoming tougher and tougher. And physicians, again, imagine, again, you going to school for 12 plus years only to have someone who, you know, does not have your background in medicine and your background in medical knowledge tell you what and how to do it, right? I can tell you right now, in the hospital setting, right, it's something that I deal with all the time now, right, even all the time now, where I have people who are administrators, people who are hospital staff, people who are even nursing staff, right? I have all of these people who go by, you know, what a guideline says, and then they want you to practice that way, right? Like, they have totally taken out the patient in the equation, right? Now, for example, like, you know, again, we won't delve too far into this, right? But for patients who come into the hospital, right, and they come in for stroke-like symptoms. For patients who come in with a stroke-like symptoms, you know, Medicare recommends that, you know what, you should order a cholesterol panel. You should put them on cholesterol medication. And I have, you know, again, administrators, people who work in the office, right, who will track me down if I don't order that cholesterol panel. Even though this patient just had a stroke and they can't move the left side of their body, to them, the most important thing is make sure I order that cholesterol level, right? Because they get deemed from it, right? They get penalized from it, right? And that's kind of what's happening, right? We've kind of taken the patient out of the equation. Again, is that cholesterol panel important to know? Maybe. Most likely, I'm going to put them on those types of medication anyway, right? But, like, from a guideline, from a rule standpoint, it says I got to order that cholesterol panel first, right? So these are just some of the, you know, annoying things from a regulatory standpoint that physicians are facing. And, again, if we're facing it in the inpatient realm, you best believe they're facing it in the outpatient realm where certain tests cannot even be ordered unless certain diagnosis attached to it, right? Like, you have, you know, computer-generated insurance models essentially dictating whether a test gets approved or not, right? And you have physicians having to then waste their time and call, you know, a physician on the other end and plead their case, essentially saying, this is why I need you to approve this test, right? And it happens all the time, right? And again, so, you know, the regulation is really driving a wedge between your physician and your physician's happiness. Number three, right? Lack of respect, right? Again, I kind of alluded to it earlier, right? There's a lack of respect that continues to go on amongst your physicians, amongst the medical community, to the outside world, right? There's a lack of respect for that physician who's done all of their training, done all their years of work, only to have someone who has a website, right? Or someone who's able to Google and tell them, no, you know what? Yes, even though I know you went to school for this, you did this extra training for this, I'm going to listen to this website that I Googled, right? Again, that's some of the tough things that, you know, that physicians are running to more and more, especially my outpatient doctors are running to more and more on an outpatient basis. Again, I used to have patients, you know, we would call them, you know, our Googling patients, right? Because whenever they came to my office, right, they always had this printout paper to give me because they wanted me to read and see, like, hey, Dr. Pierre, this is what I'm on right now. What do you think about this, right? So, again, it happens a lot. And patients, again, the patient choice is there, right? Again, I'm not knocking patient choice, right? But when it comes in the setting of disrespecting and, you know, belittling your physician's work over the years, right? Again, that's when the problems arise. And last but not least is the lack of control. Your physician, your outpatient physician, your inpatient physician, your physician who works and goes to nursing homes, your physician who goes to rehab centers, your physician who maybe see patients in a home, right? There's this lack of control that just something that they've lost, right? Again, I alluded to my old attending who said if he could go back in time, he would own things, right? He would, instead of renting, right? Because that was something that he didn't realize was so important. And the lack of control, right? Of being able to control your own destiny, right? Being able to control your own salary, being able to control your own time when you want to work, when you don't want to work, right? A lot of physicians are giving that up or are losing that control, losing that battle, and it's frustrating the hell out of them. When I say it's frustrating the hell out of them, right? Again, I'm not saying that they're making poor medical choices, right? What I'm saying is that now they're essentially kind of, you know, putting it back on the patient, right? So again, you may not realize it, right? And again, I want you, especially my lunch and learn community, you know, next time you go to your doctor, right? You know, you'll notice, see if your doctor is, how happy your doctor is, right? And see if your doctor is one of those ones who always is complaining about, you know, the company they're working for, or always complaining about having to see so many patients, right? Or always complaining about, you know, the amount of paperwork they have to do, right? See if your physician's one of those physicians, right? And again, and that may mean that your physician is one of those frustrated doctors that I'm kind of referring to, right? Because honestly, there's a lot of them. right? There's a lot of them. You know, the numbers are just going to keep on increasing because, again, physicians are making less money. Physicians are having less control. There's more regulation. There's less respect out there. So, you know, that number is only going to continue to build. And I feel fortunate, right? I feel fortunate that I'm young and I'm naive, right? And because I'm young and naive, right? Like, I feel like, you know what? That's not going to be me, right? I'm hoping, right? I'm saying, you know, that's not going to be me, right? And I don't think it is anyway, because a lot of these issues that they have a problem with, I have a problem with them now. And I'm doing stuff about them now, right? Instead of waiting, you know, 20, 30 years where it's too late to do stuff about it, right? And that's why I really admire my physician colleagues, my health professional colleagues in general, but especially my physician colleagues who are looking to do more and who are looking to expand their brand and looking to try something different, right? And again, I do the podcast, I do the blogging, I do the videos, right? And I do that because I don't want you to only think that the only way I exist in this world of medicine, right, is when you come to see me in the office, right? Or now in the setting where you come see me in the hospital, right? I want you to understand that my goal is to educate, to empower, to keep health on your priority list, right? Because again, I know for a lot of people, it isn't, for lots of different reasons, right? And if anything that I can do to make health move up in that top five, top three, I'm going to do it. So again, that's where we're at now. Again, for all of my Lunch and Learn community listeners, understand that Dr. Barry is not frustrated. Dr. Barry is very happy where he's at right now. But understand that, again, there's a lot more physicians out there who aren't as happy, who aren't as in control as I am. And those may be the ones who you say, you know what, always seem to have like a chip on the shoulder, always seem to be upset at the world. And hopefully after listening to this episode, you kind of understand the reason why. And last but not least, remember, the goal of our community is to empower you, to help you take care of yourself, take control of your health, so you can live longer and a more peaceful life. I'm going to see you guys next week. Thank you for listening to another episode of the Lunch and Learn with Dr. Barry. Please head over to lunchlearnpod.com, where you'll get the most recent episodes as well as today's show notes for your listening and viewing pleasure. And like always, depending on where you're listening this to, please subscribe to the podcast so you can get all the latest episodes sent directly to you. And we are at all of your favorite podcast listening stations, including Apple Podcasts, Google Play, SoundCloud, iHeartRadio, Spotify, and Stitcher Radio. Again, thank you for taking the time to listen and empower yourself to take control of your health, and we'll see you next week.